Welcome to today's lesson, Learn Write Integrated Science. In our previous lesson, we studied something on transport. We talked about diffusion, osmosis. We established that osmosis can take place in living tissues and non-living tissue. So today, I want us to concentrate, demonstrate how osmosis occurs in a living tissue. How osmosis occurs in a living tissue. How osmosis occurs in a living tissue. In every experiment, there are certain things you should know. Number one, you should know the title or the aim. Why are you carrying out such an experiment? So you should give a suitable title or aim to the experiment. So for this, our title or our aim is to find out and establish whether osmosis can take place in a living tissue or not. So our aim is that an experiment to demonstrate osmosis in a living tissue. An experiment to demonstrate osmosis in a living tissue. Apart from that, what are the things that you need? The apparatus, the materials. Number one, you need beakers. Beakers or water trough. So you can use beakers or water trough or any other suitable containers. Then the next one, you also need semi-permeable membranes. If you remember the definition, I said movement is so and so and so through a semi-permeable membrane. So once you are dealing with a living tissue, what are some examples of these living tissues that can serve as semi-permeable membrane? What we have, yam. We can use yam that can serve as semi-permeable membrane. I hope you all seen yam before. Then in place of yam, we can use cassava, a tuber of cassava, not the plant or the stem. The tuber, that is the fruit from the cassava plant, a tuber of cassava. Apart from these two, we can also use unripe pawpaw. Unripe pawpaw. Unripe pawpaw. You can use it. Then, quite apart from these three that I've shown them to you, we can use potato. Potato or cocoyam tuber. Any one of these that I've mentioned could be used as a living tissue that will serve as semi-permeable membrane. Now, you've got to know the aim, the materials that are needed for the experiment. The next thing is the procedure or the method, the ways, or how you are going to carry out the experiment. Now let me go back. I've mentioned that we need yam. Yam. So it's the yam, in this case, you are going to use as our semi-permeable membranes. The remaining, maybe at another time, you try them. This is the yam. Then you also need salt. Forgot to mention salt. What's the function of the salt? The salt will bring out the differences in concentration. In place of salt, you can also use sugar. Then we also need knife, kitchen knife, for peeling of the yam or the cassava. We need water. So I have my water here. These are some of the things that we need for this experiment. Now, how do you go about it? The method, the procedure. We come to that, how you go about it. After the method, after you have carried out the experiment, what are your observations? Taking critical look at the experiment. So you have to write your observations. After the observation, the last one is what? Conclusion. What inferences can you make from the observations? So these are the five key things one should know when you want to carry out any experiment. Number one, I said the aim of the experiment. Number two, the materials, apparatus. Number three, the method or procedure. Number four, observations. And the last one is conclusion. So these are the processes when you want to carry out, or the things you should know when you want to carry out any demonstration. Remember, I said we are going to, our aim for this experiment is that we want to carry out, we want to illustrate, we want to demonstrate how osmosis occurs in a living tissue. So I have my tuba of yam here. The first thing you do is that you have to peel off the yam. You take off the outer skin. So you see me, I'm doing it. I'm peeling it off. After peeling, then you cut. You cut part of it into two different shapes. And I prefer the cube shapes. After that, you scrape, or you make a cavity or hole. The hole is H-O-L-E. You take off the carbohydrates inside it, some of them, not all, some of them inside it, to create a hole or cavity in the yam. But remember, you are cutting two, so the depth of it and then the diameter of the two should be the same, as I've already done here. So you look at them. I've created the hole inside them. They have the same depth and the same diameter. So that is step two. Then step three, you place each one of them in the beaker. Or the water trough, or any suitable containers like this, as I've done it here. Then you label A and then B. After that,
I'll measure the water. This is 250 mils of water. Then I'll pour it in water trough B with the yam cube. Then I pour this one to in the trough A with the yam cube. So have you seen that the levels of the water in the two beakers or the water trough are the same? I want you to observe. Then the next thing is that I have to prepare my salt solution. This is my salt. That is water. Was, remember, under the fish, you say if you want to facilitate, you can stir to agitate the particles to move at a faster rate. So whilst it's dissolving, let me pour water and measure it. Just 5 mils. Yes, this is 5 mils. Then I'll pour it into the yam cube labeled B. This is ordinary water. There's nothing in it. This is my sole solution. Also going to pour it. I have to measure with the same quantity of the water that I poured into the yam cube B. So this is the sole solution. Also measured 5. Then I pour the sole solution into the yam cube labeled A. Now, we are finished, but let's look at something. The definition says that movement of water molecules from region of concentrated water across a semi-permeable membrane to where the water molecules are less. So the water in the beaker is higher. That is the molecules of the water. You can see visibly. We measure 250 mL. Then the one that you poured, we use for the dilution of the salt, was less, just 5 mils. So the water in the beaker is more highly concentrated than the one that is found in the yam cube with the salt. That is number one. And remember, I've told you that in osmosis, it's the water molecules that move. Whilst the water that we use for dissolving the salt is less. Then number three, the definition says across a semi-permeable membrane. For this experiment, we are using the yam as a semi-permeable membrane. So you can look at it. The three things, conditions that should be present. Number one, water molecules, higher concentration, plenty of water. Two, the yam cube serving as the semi-permeable membrane. Then the concentration, that's a salt or sugar solution. These are the conditions. So this is the actual experiment. One, we have more water in the beaker. Two, we have our semi-permeable membrane. Then three, we have the concentrated salt solution in the yam cap or the cavity or the hole. This is the actual experiment. The other one, let's see what will happen at the end. We have plenty of water in the beaker. We have ordinary water, 5 mils. Ordinary water, there's nothing in it. In the second yam cube, that is labeled B. We are going to leave. Remember, before that, before we leave the experiment for 24 hours, remember, we have ordinary water in the yam cube, sorry, in the beaker. Ordinary water, there's nothing in it. Though it's not distilled water. So it may contain some impurities, but you are not looking at that. Then in the yam cube, we have the same ordinary water. It is also not distilled water. So there's no differences in concentration. Ordinary water in the beaker, ordinary water in the yam cube. Then the yam serves as our semi-permeable membrane. So in this one, there's no differences in concentration. So students, let's leave the experiment for 24 hours. You say, hey, yes, hey, let's wait after 24 hours and see if there will be significant differences between the two experiments. This is the beginning of the two experiments. After 24 hours, we are going to come out with our observations and our conclusions. Students, welcome back. We left the experiment for 24 hours. So we are going to continue, observe what has really happened, what has taken place after the 24 hours. Now, let's look at the experiment A. I hope you're not forgetting the level of the water that was in the beaker, and then the level of salt solution in the yam cup. Now let's look at the two. What significant differences has taken place? Look at experiment B. Remember, we had ordinary water in the beaker or the water trough, then ordinary water in the yam cup. Has there been any increase or decrease in the levels of the water? Look at them critically and then come out with your answers. Let's go back to experiment A. Now we can see that or observe that the water, the ordinary water in the water trough has decreased drastically, whilst the sugar solution in the yam cup has risen. What accounted for that? What brought about the decrease and the increase in the levels of the two solutions? Then you come to the B. The water level in the water trough remains the same. There's no increase or decrease. Then the water level in the yam cup also remains the same. What accounted for that? We have our semi-permeable, all right. Why is it that the water molecules could not penetrate to cause an increase in the yam cup? Why is it that there's an increase in the water level in the yam cup whilst there's a decrease, in the water in the water trough? Okay, do you have answers to these questions? Yes. If you look at the definition, it says that it's the movement of water molecules from a region of higher concentration. That is the water. I told you it's the water that moves, water particles that moves. So because there was differences in concentration, ordinary water in the water trough and salt solution in the yam cup or the cavity that we created or the hole, there was differences in concentration. And because of that, the water molecules in the water trough moved through the yam cup, which was permeable or is permeable, that allowed the particles to move through to cause an increase in the level of the salt solution in the yam cup. So students, we can conclude that before osmosis can take place, one, there should be a semi-permeable membrane. Two, there should be differences in concentration. Now, assuming we take off the semi, that's the yam cubes, then in place of that, we use plastic cup. What do you think would happen after the 24 hours? Look at the yam cup. You can even pour in salt solution to it. Then wait after 24 hours. What do you think will happen? Yes, I'm waiting for you. Yes, you are there. There will be no movement of water, salt. Why? The plastic cup is impermeable to water. That is, it will not allow water to penetrate or pass through. And therefore, the level of the salt solution in the plastic cup and that of the water trough, they remain the same. That is why I said it's a condition that
there should be a presence of semi-permeable membrane. Now, what is the function of the yam? That's the yam cap or the, yes, the yam cap. The function is that it's serving as what? A semi-permeable membrane. A semi-permeable membrane that allows the water to pass through. What about the salts? The salt will serve as what? Differences in concentration. Differences between the ordinary water and then the concentrated solution in the yam cap. This experiment can also be found in the form of drawings in Approach's new integrated science textbook, chapter 14. For more clarification, if you haven't got your copy yet, as I've been telling you, if you don't take care, it will get finished. So hurry up and grab your copy. Now, with all these things that you've done or demonstrated, I want to use diagrams on the board to explain it better for you to understand. So when it comes to examination, and then there's a question on osmosis, as far as living tissue is concerned, you're able to answer it perfectly. So go with me onto the board. So like I said, every experiment you have to state your aim. So our aim is to an experiment to demonstrate osmosis in a living tissue. An experiment to demonstrate osmosis in a living tissue. That is the aim of the experiment. The things that we need, mention them, that we need water, we need salt, we need yam, and the like. Now I have two setups. Setup A, then setup B. The setup A is the actual experiment, whilst the setup B is the control experiment. The setup A, this is the beginning of the experiment, and this is the end of the experiment. Then you come to setup B, the beginning of the experiment and the end of the experiment. Now, let me take the setup A. We have our beaker. This is our beaker. Our beaker with water. Just water. Then, the beaker is full of water, as indicated in the diagram. Then we have our yam cap. This is our yam cap. It is a living one, not dead, as we demonstrated just now. Living yam. That is the cavity, the hole that we created in the yam. You can see it here, you can see it there, and even here. Then what we see, the reddish color that we see, represents the salt solution. The salt solution in order to create the differences in concentration. So this is the salt solution. So you fill the beaker with water as you've done it already. Then you pour the salt solution into the yam cup. Then you indicate the level, mark the level, so that if there's any increase or decrease in the level. And what do you use to mark the level? Most of the time, we use an indelible ink. So when it comes in contact with water, it cannot be easy and rub off or washed off. Now, after I've poured the water, so the sugar salt solution into the yam cup, you mark the level. Then the water level too, you mark the level. Then you leave it for 24 hours. Then that of the controlled experiment. This is our beaker filled with water. Then you pour another water, that's the ordinary water, into the yam cup instead of salt solution. So, ordinary water in the beaker, then ordinary water in the yam cup. So this one, there's no differences between the two. Unlike the first one, that the setup A, we have salt solution in the yam cup, the ordinary water in the beaker. So there's differences in concentration here, but when it comes here, there's no differences in what? Concentration. Leaving it for 24 hours. After 24 hours, it could be observed that this is the beginning and that is the end. Now you can see that the water level in the yam cup, that is the salt solution, the level of salt solution in the beaker has what? Increased, gone up drastically. You can see from here, or you can see, look at it well, it has gone down. Sorry, it has gone up. So, what brought about the differences? Whilst the water level in the beaker has also gone down drastically, look at the level at the beginning and look at the level at the end. There's a drastic decrease in the level of the water in the beaker. That is the beginning, that is the end. We come up back to it and then give the reasons. Then you come to setup B after the 24 hours. We realize that the water level in the yam cup remains the same, whilst the water level in the beaker also remains the same. What accounted for that? Now, with the setup B, there's no differences in the beginning and that of the end. Why? One, there was no differences in concentration. And for osmosis to occur, one of the conditions is that there should be differences in concentration. And because there was no differences in concentration, the water molecules in the beaker could not pass through the yam to increase the level of what? The water. So there was no net movement of water. So osmosis did not take place in the setup B. Then we come to setup A. Why the increase and why the decrease? There was an increase in the level of salt solution in the yam cup because the water in the beaker, it was low in concentration. There was nothing in it. And because of that, the molecules were attracted to move through the yam cup to cause an increase in the level of the salt solution in the yam cup. Apart from that, the yam cup also serves as semi-permeable membrane, and it allows the water molecules to pass through. That is why there's an increase in the level of the salt solution in the yam cup, whilst there's decrease in the level of the water in the beaker. And this is telling us that osmosis has taken place in the living tissue, that is the yam. Any question? There's no question. Then, why diffusion? That is the application of osmosis and diffusion. If you could remember, at the beginning of the experiment or the lesson, I asked you some questions. The differences between this tilapia and that. That this is dried and that is fresh contains water. So by what principles do you use to preserve fish, to be specific, tilapia? Now I have my salt here. Where is my salt? So that's my salt. I want to apply it onto the fresh tilapia. Then you leave it for some time. As soon as you apply it, then leave it for some time. What happens is that because the tilapia contains water, the cells, the tissues of the tilapia, remember, under cells, so all living things are made up of cells. And once a tilapia is a living thing, it also contains cells. So the water in the tilapia, where the water is highly concentrated, it will move from the tissues or the cells of the tilapia into the salt outside the tilapia. And if you should leave this for some time, see that as time goes on, all the water in the tilapia will come out, leaving the tilapia dry. And that will make the conditions in the tilapia unfavorable for microorganisms to thrive or to survive under such conditions. As soon as there's osmotic pressure, the water in it is drawn out. One, the microorganisms, remember, the tilapia also contains microorganisms. So as soon as the water is sucked, is drawn outside, it makes them to become dehydrated. That's the microorganisms. And therefore, they cannot thrive under such conditions. So they'll be starved and then died. So that's the principle of drying tilapia. Then, another one is how to preserve or concentrate fruit juice. That this bowl contains solution of sugar. So if you want to reduce the water content in the orange, you place the orange into the solution, which is highly concentrated with sugar, so that the water molecules in the orange will be drawn to decrease the solution, the sugar solution in the water trough, and that will make the concentration in the orange higher than the one that is found in this. So from all the discussion that we've had on this topic, I want to refer you to Approaches series, the new Approaches. We have a question came on this. Perform an experiment to demonstrate how osmosis occurs in a living tissue. So refer to chapter 14, pages 281, 282. The questions are there with solutions. After that, if there's anything concerning this topic you don't understand, then you can send us your questions to our page so that we can answer you. Thank you for today's lesson. I hope you have enjoyed this lesson and benefited. And I hope you are going to apply some of them to your everyday activities. Next week or in our next meeting, we are going to continue on the same topic but under different subheading. Thank you for watching.